In this video, we briefly introduce electromagnetic waves, the speed of electromagnetic waves, the relationship between wavelength, speed, and frequency, how we generate electromagnetic waves, and finally the electromagnetic spectrum. We start by looking at the basic structure of electromagnetic waves. So we've already established that moving charges create magnetic field, and if we get a little more abstract about that, we can say changing electric fields would result in changing magnetic fields. We also know that changing magnetic fields induce electric fields, and this was called Lenz's law. So an electromagnetic wave is a wave that propagates through space, with the changing electric field inducing a magnetic field, the changing magnetic field inducing an electric field, and so on. And you'll notice in the picture these induced fields are at right angles to each other. One interesting point about these waves is that unlike transverse waves on a string, electromagnetic waves don't require any medium in which to travel, so they can travel right through a vacuum. A second big point is that the speed of an electromagnetic wave is a universal constant of nature, and it's about 3×10⁸ meters per second. This is true for all wavelengths and consequently all frequencies of electromagnetic radiation. When we talk about electromagnetic waves, we ordinarily just refer to what the electric field portion is doing. So the wave we showed in the top picture could be represented instead by a two-dimensional picture, where I'm just showing what's going on with the electric field. The wave we're looking at is said to be polarized in the y direction because the electric field is oscillating up and down completely parallel to the y-axis. Generally in nature, you'll find light with random polarization and a mixture of different phases. But to keep things simple, we have one pure wave with a vertical polarization. Notice in the diagram on the bottom, I've labeled the wavelength of the wave. That's the distance to get from one crest to the next, or one trough to the next. In general, the distance before the wave starts to repeat itself. And I've also labeled the amplitude as E naught, so that's the maximum magnitude of the electric field. And of course, there's the wave speed as this wave travels along at the speed of light. Electromagnetic waves follow the same speed, frequency, and wavelength relation as a wave on a string. That's V equals F lambda, where the frequency is the frequency of the wiggling of this electric field. I've already explained what the wavelength is, and then the speed is the speed of light, which we normally use the symbol C for, so we could replace the V in this equation with a C, and we get C equals F lambda. This equation allows us to relate the frequency and the wavelength for electromagnetic waves. So here's a couple short examples of how to do this. In the first example, we're told the frequency of an AM radio station is 1530 kilohertz, and I want to compute the wavelength of these radio waves. Now, part of the point of this example is just to point out that radio waves are one type of electromagnetic radiation. To get the wavelength, I solve my little equation for lambda, and that's just C over F. Remember, the prefix kilo means 10 to the third, so 1530 times 10 to the third hertz. And a hertz is an oscillation per second. Oscillations don't formally have a unit associated with them, so the units can be written as 1 over seconds. I see that the seconds cancel, and I'm left with meters, so this is good. Into three significant digits, I get a wavelength of 196 meters for these radio waves. So radio waves have very long wavelengths. They can go a lot longer than that. In the second example, we turn the problem around. So we're given the wavelength of this carbon monoxide emission line as 2.6 millimeters. So this is a common observational wavelength in astronomy because the carbon monoxide in the molecular clouds in the galactic disk emits electromagnetic radiation at this wavelength. So astronomers use this to map molecular clouds. So I use the same equation, but I solve for F this time. I'm looking for the frequency of this electromagnetic radiation, and I get C over lambda. And I need to shift the decimal point because I have millimeters. And I can see the meters cancel, and I'm left with units of 1 over seconds, which is a hertz. And when I run the numbers, I get a frequency of 1.15 times 10 to the 11 hertz. It might be nice to transform that to gigahertz. So a gigahertz is 10 to the 9, so I could write it as 115 gigahertz. So that means the electric field for these electromagnetic waves is wiggling 115 billion times per second. So one way that electromagnetic waves are created is with an oscillating charge. So in this picture, this red thing is a radio antenna, and we're driving charge up and down it with a sinusoidal signal. That's why I put the little wave in the circle there. And when you drive charge up and down in this vertical line, electromagnetic waves propagate most intensely in the perpendicular direction. And that's what this graph is trying to illustrate. The distance from the origin is telling you the intensity of the radiation in that direction. So I get maximum intensity perpendicular to the direction of the oscillating charge. That intensity drops off as I move to angles that are closer and closer to being parallel to the direction of oscillation. And I notice in particular that there's zero electromagnetic radiation propagating parallel to the motion of the charges. So if I observe from up here, I'll just put an eyeball up here. I don't see any electromagnetic waves coming off of this antenna in that direction. If I observe over here, just put an eyeball in there real quick, I get the maximum intensity from this antenna. So whether it's a radio antenna or an oscillating molecule in the atmosphere, this idea of the direction of maximum intensity and the direction of zero intensity in particular is going to be important for understanding a couple ways that polarized light is created in nature. Finally, electromagnetic radiation comes in a huge range of frequencies and wavelengths, all the way from the lowest energy electromagnetic waves, those are the radio waves, with the longest wavelengths and the smallest frequencies, to the highest energy electromagnetic radiation, those are the gamma rays, with the smallest wavelengths and enormous frequencies. So we often refer to all of these as light, even though the electromagnetic radiation corresponding to visible light only comes in a fairly narrow band here. You'll notice that wavelengths that are slightly less than the visible band are called ultraviolet. They have frequencies that are greater than that of violet light, wavelengths that are smaller. On the other side of the visible spectrum, we have the infrared light. So that's light that's less energetic than red light, has longer wavelengths, and it has smaller frequencies. So we see in a band that's basically 400 nanometers to 700 nanometers. In this blown up view of the visible spectrum, it's extended a little all the way to a smallest wavelength of 380 and a biggest of 750. And so all the different colors that we see correspond to just different wavelengths of light in this narrow band. Shortest wavelengths are violet, longest wavelengths are red. And you may have seen this mnemonic before, but you can remember the order of these things with this mnemonic, Roy G. Biv, which actually orders these things from the longest wavelength all the way to the shortest wavelength. Red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, violet. Now you might complain, what's the difference between blue and indigo? And I'm definitely in that camp, but apparently it's a color somewhere between blue and violet. We wrap things up with a couple simple examples, just talking about frequencies and wavelengths again. And in the first one, I want the frequency of 633 nanometer red laser light. So this is the classic red laser light. And we just do the familiar calculation C over lambda. And nano means 10 to the negative ninth. And I get a frequency of 4.74 times 10 to the 14 hertz. Again, that's extremely fast wiggling. In the second example, we have an X-ray. So part of my motivation here is just to point out that X-rays are a type of electromagnetic wave. And it has a frequency of 1.5 times 10 to the 19 hertz, and I want the wavelength. So I do the familiar calculation, lambda C over F. And I get a wavelength of 2 times 10 to the negative 11 meters. I could express that in nanometers, which is a pretty common unit for comparison. And that would be 0.02 nanometers. So the light we see is several hundred nanometers. X-rays are significantly shorter wavelength than that. So measured in hundreds of nanometers in this case. If you find the physics content on Zach's Lab helpful, click on the Zach's Lab logo on the right to browse playlists and subscribe to the channel. I produce over 100 new videos per month, and subscribing is the easiest way to find new content. Thanks for watching.